taking your questions on all aspects of personal finance, and for the first programme, concentrating on savings and investments. There's no single answer to the question, where can I get the best return, but Moneybox Live will look at the options and opportunities. 03 03 700 100 444 is a number to call. The lines are open now. They're quite quiet at the moment, but they won't be when the programme starts after the 3 o'clock news. So get dialing now. 03 700 100 444.
Thanks very much, Vincent. And Moneybox Live is in 45 minutes. Now on BBC Radio 4, the afternoon play. Towards the end of his career, the movie star Peter Lorre found himself centre stage in a strange court case. Our play this afternoon wonders what was going through his troubled mind at the time. Peter Lorre versus Peter Lorre by Michael Butt.
Dear Mr. Lorre, may I introduce myself? I'm sure you get lots of letters from the general public, the Joe Schmoes who just want to get involved in your life. I promise you, I'm not one of those. If I may explain, for some time now I felt there was a connection between us that I don't understand. Though I've never met you, I feel I know you somehow. Do you think we could meet for maybe half an hour? You could help me straighten this out. As I say, I'm not one of those nutcases just wanting to bother you, and I'd be so grateful for a little of your time. Do you think you could call me on the number at the top of this letter? I'm waiting to hear from you. Yours with sincerest admiration, Eugene Weingand. P.S. I really like your films.
So, Peter, tell us, there's a question a lot of people must ask.
What's that, Jack?
Well, it's this. Okay, so in your movies, and you have made such a distinguished career in Hollywood, but the question is this. You've mainly played what I would call ghoulish characters.
That's true.
You've made a career out of monsters.
Don't forget the maniacs. Monsters or maniacs, I don't like to be typecast. Sorry, Jack, you were asking a question.
But the question is this. Put simply...
I wish you'd get to it, Jack. I've got a midnight train to catch to Transylvania.
Are you going back to see the old folks?
Ah, bless them.
So here's my question, then. And as I say, it's a question I'm sure a lot of people want to ask. You're playing a lot of these killers, serial killers.
Mm-hmm.
A really unpleasant sort. But what is the real Peter Lorre like? I mean, who is the man beneath the mask?
The man beneath the mask?
That's right.
Shall I tell you?
We're waiting.
He doesn't exist.
What?
Beneath the mask? Zero. Nothing. Jack, I'm kidding around with you here. What am I like? Let me tell you. I am the sweetest man you'll ever meet. I am the man whose sensitivities are touched by the cry of a child and the cheep-cheep of a wounded sparrow. It's true. The crushed petals of a damaged petunia make me weep.
Now I know you're kidding.
No, it's the way I am. And if you don't believe me, well, I'd cut your heart out. I want it all. Just like the girl that murdered your old dad. I'm coming to get ya! I'm coming to get ya!
Did I tell you, Peter? Maureen loved you. She caught the jackpot. Loved it.
Uh-huh.
I want a ghoul. You knocked her out.
Are you worried about me, Lester?
No.
Then what are all these compliments for?
You are a very suspicious man. How long have I been your agent?
Oh, I don't know.
The contract for Tales of Terror.
Ah.
We are late in signing.
Now I understand.
Barclay wants it back by 4. Why not sign it now, huh?
Okay.
Something he told me, huh?
What's that?
It's going to interest you.
What is?
You will not believe. Some fruitcake has filed a deposition. He wants to use your name. Believe that?
I don't understand.
He must be letting them out of the nut house early.
What did he do?
I'm saying he wants to use your name.
This man?
I can't find the damn thing.
Well, who is he?
I don't remember his name.
We can't do it.
Of course you can't do it. They're fighting him.
The studio?
Oh, yes.
You got this from Barclay?
Today. Ah, here it is. You got a pen?
Is this weird, Lester?
Peter, this is Hollywood. Weird is what we do.
Well, why would anybody want to be me?
Are you kidding?
I want it stopped.
Our lawyer is going to eat him. Weingand.
Huh?
The fruitcake's name. I just remembered.
What else do you know?
Nothing. German. He's like you. He's German. Works in real estate. Wants to call himself Peter Lorre Jr.
So?
That's all I have. They're going into court next week.
It must be stopped.
What did I just say? It will be stopped. You going to sign this thing?
That's all the information we have?
I'll get the deposition papers. You want to see them before we go to court? I'll get them. Now, Peter.
Oh, he's making a mistake.
He is making a mistake. But then he's mad and he's a German, sir. What can you expect? The contract now.
I'm going out.
Peter.
Sign it later.
Take the stand, please, Mr. Weingand. Be seated, please, and state your name.
Eugene Weingand.
A little bit louder, please.
Eugene Weingand.
You are the petitioner in this action. Is that correct?
Yes.
And you now live at 2323 Valentine Street, Hollywood 28, California.
Yes.
Your present name is Eugene Weingand. W-E-I-N-G-A-N-D.
Yes.
And you propose to change your name to Peter Lorre Jr.
Yes.
The only reason for it you set forth in your petition is that the name of Weingand is difficult to pronounce.
Yes.
What's hard to pronounce about Weingand? Well, that's your privilege. Have you any other reasons why you want your name changed?
Because everybody calls me Peter Lorre.
Anyone ever call you Bob Hope?
Not yet.
Jack Benny?
No.
Danny Thomas?
No.
George Jessel?
No.
They haven't called you any of these names?
No.
You are not filing this petition for the purpose of hindering, delaying, or defrauding creditors?
No.
Any further questions, counsel, you want to ask your client?
I think that covers everything, Your Honor.
Mr. Shuten, you want to ask this witness any questions?
Yes, I do, sir.
When we get through, I have some questions I want to ask him.
And have you been using the name Peter Lorre?
Yes, I have.
How long have you been using the name Peter Lorre Jr.?
About a year and a half, 2 years.
And what is your occupation?
I'm a real estate salesman.
Mm-hmm. And do you use the name Peter Lorre or Peter Lorre Jr. in your occupation?
Yes, I do.
You see what he's doing? Relax. Lester, you know... What? This is a bizarre experience for me.
Yes,
we're gonna nail him.
This is your standard method of introducing yourself, is it not?
Sort of, yes.
Mr. Weingand, were you ever in the theatrical business?
I've done a little bit of stage work.
Yeah. What kind of stage work?
Oh, no, no, no,
no. Small theater. Just a little small part.
Oh, I'm sure.
Do you know what it means to try to develop a name in the theatrical field?
Perhaps, yes.
How would you feel if your name was Peter Lorre and someone came in and wanted to use that same name after you developed it for over a period of 30 years? Would you be happy to have someone take that name?
Your Honor, I very timidly voice my objection.
Don't be timid with me, counsel. Make your objection. I love to argue with lawyers.
I really see no point in this line of questioning.
It doesn't go that easy, counsel. A man has the right to come in and protect his name. Why doesn't he call himself Barry Goldwater or Lou Rockefeller?
Maybe he doesn't look like Lou Goldwater or Rockefeller or whatever the names are. He looks like Peter Lorre, evidently. That's what his friends say.
I'm sorry you said that, counsel. Isn't that exactly what he's trying to do? Cash in on the same facial resemblance or voice resemblance, perhaps?
Not in the same field, Your Honor.
He looks like you. Isn't that funny?
I don't think he looks like me.
Minor facial resemblance?
Mm.
What?
I don't think they're handling it right.
What's that?
They're making fun of him in there. Is that the right strategy?
Mockery. Never fails.
Well, he's just gonna end up looking vulnerable.
No, I don't think so.
Next, they're going to feel sorry for him.
Relax, Peter.
They might think, well, why shouldn't he use this man's name?
Point A, they're making fun of him because he's loopy and the case has got holes in it. And B...
So, is it in their hands?
Whose hands?
I mean, is it? Is it?
Whose hands is it in? The judge. You heard what the judge said. He's on your side.
I'm sorry. I don't feel...
We go back in. Listen to me. We go back in and kick that Kraut's nutty little ass.
It's not your name.
What?
It's not your name, Lester, is it?
Buck up. The cavalry's arrived.
Mr. Barkley.
How are you, Lester?
I am very well.
And Peter?
Peter's a little nervous.
Why? I understand. The publicity. Don't worry about it. It's being managed. And remember what they say. There is no bad publicity except being found in bed with two raccoons. Am I right, Lester?
That's what I'm saying to him, Mr. Barkley.
There is only room for one Peter Lorre.
You hear that, Peter?
You are in a country where justice prevails, where right is might, and where a man's name is his badge of honor. So why are we worried? We take up arms. Keep me informed. And where's my contract?
Barkley came down. Peter, he lent his shoulder and... And it's not good business to express doubt. You coming?
Yeah, in a minute.
Don't be late.
Mr. Lorre, you're Peter Lorre, am I right?
Some people say so.
I'm so sorry for interrupting you. I had to come over and say... I wanted to say how much I enjoy your work.
Well, thank you. That's very kind.
I can't believe I'm talking to you. I'm stumbling on my words. I must seem so gauche.
I've got to go.
I understand.
It's just when somebody comes and says they admire all my pictures...
I didn't say that.
Excuse me?
I didn't say I admire all your pictures.
Then...
Can I be blunt? I admire parts of many of your pictures... Casablanca, the Maltese Falcon, these stand out. But I don't... I'm sorry. I can't admire... I mean, not all of them. In fact, in my opinion, Mr. Lorre, these were shadows of what you did in M. That, well, that was genius.
You like that film?
It had everything.
It was a long time ago.
That's nothing to do with it. The way it painted a picture of a society refusing to deal with an evil inside it. And then your character, a victim of his own twisted passion, killing those little girls, even though
he didn't want to.
He didn't want to, exactly, but he has to because...
He's lost himself.
And someone else is living inside him,
yeah.
Controlling him. Oh, how did you, with just a few gestures...
As I say, that was a long time ago.
And what a neat idea that was, giving that tune to the killer to hum.
Agree. It was my idea.
That was a great movie.
What's your name?
Helen Hafner.
You're not going to believe this, Helen. There's a man in court right now who wants to take my name.
You've got to stop him, Mr. Lorre.
But that's what I'm saying to them, because what is a name, Helen?
It's what you are.
Or what you want to be. Would you come with me back to court?
And before you came to this country, you were active in a theater group in Germany, were you not?
Yes.
I will have to object to this as being beyond the scope of direct, Your Honor.
Overruled.
And then you came to New York City, did you, after Germany?
Yes.
And you were in a little theater group in New York City?
Partly.
And at the time you filed this application for a change of name, you were active in an acting school in Hollywood.
Yes.
Are you still active in it?
Yes, I am.
And you go, what, twice a week?
Yes.
And do they know you as Peter Lorre in this acting school?
Oh, they do.
Well, that's all, Your Honor.
Mr. Gamel, just a couple of questions. Have you ever received compensation for this so-called acting?
No.
Exactly. What is this acting school that you're attending in Hollywood?
People go there for several reasons.
What is it? An acting group? A workshop?
People go there not because of becoming an actor.
What reason are you going there, Mr. Weingand?
For diction.
To improve your diction?
Yes.
Could you improve your diction under any other name?
Your Honor, they know me under both names.
Is there anything about the name of Peter Lorre that improves your diction?
I have no further questions.
Mr. Weingand, if this court were to grant an order permitting you to change your name to Peter Lorre, do you think that would increase your chance of getting compensation for your acting services?
Object to this is completely immaterial. It's delving into the future, which no man has a right to do except God.
Sustained.
All right, sir.
You may step down, Mr. Weingand.
And on that unusually uplifting note, we'll break till tomorrow.
So, who's the young woman by your side?
A friend.
Mm-hmm. Hard to your elbow.
That isn't like that.
Why would it be? So...
she's got some interesting ideas.
Let's get the contract out of the way.
I'm not signing, Lester.
How does that work?
I was talking to Helen.
Your friend?
About the old days.
I see. That's interesting.
I suddenly thought, why have I devoted my life to being in garbage?
Garbage?
You read the script?
What?
Tales of Terror. Have you read it yet?
Did I tell you they've signed Vincent Price?
It's shit, Lester.
What has that got to do with anything?
Have you read it?
Yes.
And?
And what?
What do you think of it?
What do I think? It's got a part in it for you. That's what I think.
But it's crap, isn't it?
It ain't Beaumont and Fletcher, I'll grant you.
Tell me what you think and I will sign.
I give you my opinion and you'll sign?
That's the deal.
It's crap. Now you're going to sign?
I'm not signing.
What?
Do I want to be in crap, Lester?
Where did this come from? Your friend?
No.
Then where? The court case. The court case bothering you?
This guy wants my name. You know, he's welcome to it.
Don't do this, Peter.
I was thinking about where my career began in Berlin.
This isn't going to help.
You know the biggest bastard in the world?
That's got to be Sam Goldwyn.
Adolf Hitler.
Peter!
That man ruined my life.
Yes, but that was a long time ago. This is Hollywood, 1963. We're talking about Adolf Hitler?
Had a career then.
Yes, I know.
I work with the best.
I thought, maybe I'm wrong. I thought you wanted to provide for your daughter. May I remind you of the here and now, Peter? You said to me it's the one thing you wanted to do, to be able to leave Catherine something when you go. Sign the contract. Do yourself a favor.
You sign.
What?
I make the faces, you make the deals. You sign the damn thing.
Be seated, please, and state your name.
Name is Lester Salco.
Mr. Salco, what is your occupation?
I am an artist representative, an agent.
And how long have you been in the artist representation or agency business?
I've been in the business about 24 years.
Now, Mr. Lorre is one of a considerable number of stars that is represented by your office.
Yes.
In your negotiations on behalf of a person of the stature of a star in the entertainment field, one of your objectives is to get as high a compensation as possible for your client in any particular negotiation?
Yes.
What are the elements that assist you in getting as high a fee or salary as you can?
I think foremost is the individual representation of the artist. His name and, to say it quickly, his considered box office value.
Let's put it in simple language, Mr. Salco. Suppose the court would grant the petitioner the right to change his name from Weingand to Lorre, and then that man made himself available for personal appearance. Would that have any effect on the price you might get for the original Peter Lorre?
I think without question it would.
Uh-huh. Agents advertise their clients. I imagine you do too, once in a while, in Variety or The Reporter. Anything further, Mr. Shuten?
Well, that's all, Your Honor.
You may cross-examine, counsel.
Do you happen to know a Peter Lorre of 2507 East 19th Street in Brooklyn, New York?
It hasn't been my pleasure.
How do you know it's a pleasure?
Do you know if he's in the entertainment field?
I object to this. It hasn't been established that there is a Peter Lorre.
He says he hasn't met him. How can he answer your next question? Let him answer if he can.
You wouldn't know whether he's in the entertainment field or the garage field, would you?
No, sir.
Do you know a Peter Lorre of 42 Leduc Drive, Ontario, Canada?
Object to this. It hasn't been established.
Objection sustained, Mr. Gemmell.
In your 24 years as an agent for actors, I think you said that the name factor is the most important in your negotiations on behalf of that person.
Yes.
And you also said they had to have acting ability. This is a necessity?
Certainly one of the requirements, yes.
And if they didn't have this ability, you as a successful agent wouldn't be representing them, is that right?
That's a pretty broad statement.
Counsel asked you a hypothetical question concerning whether or not, if you were just representing a famous actor and another actor came upon the scene using the same name, whether or not this, in your opinion, would reduce or damage in any respect the party whom you represented. And your answer to that question was that unquestionably it would. Is that true?
Yes.
Let me ask you another hypothetical. You represent the actor Peter Lorre. And as such, you approach producers of movies, television shows, personal appearances, etc. If there was a real estate broker using the name Peter Lorre, bringing it right down to what we have before His Honor today, selling real estate in North Hollywood, and was not engaged in show business in any form or fashion, would this in any sense reduce or impair the earning ability of your client Peter Lorre?
Counsel. Your hypothetical doesn't go far enough. Your client has testified that he has been engaged in the theatrical business even as a child actor over in Germany. He testified that he's done some theatrical work here, although he limited it to improving his diction. And at that time, I asked him, couldn't you improve your diction under some other name? Objection sustained.
I take exception to that, if I may be heard further.
You have that right.
Mr. Weingand's answer to my question as to why he was going to acting school...
To improve his diction.
Period. He did not say it was to engage in the entertainment field.
Counsel, I assure you I am over 21.
Well, I hope I am also, Your Honor.
I know you are.
In fact, I think we all are. But if this man has no aspirations to enter into show business, and this is, as of this date, that...
Will they stop you making pictures?
Well, I don't know.
Wouldn't that be a shame?
No, I don't know. It might be a good thing. I couldn't pay my bills.
Oh, gee.
Your ice cream good?
Why don't you make M again?
I'm sorry?
M? You could make it again. This time in English.
I don't think so.
Why?
Well, for one thing, it's already been done.
I didn't know that.
A few years ago.
Were you in it?
No.
Why not?
They didn't ask me.
But it was your picture.
They didn't think so.
But you've got to do it.
I'll tell them you said so.
You must do it.
Helen, have you noticed how old I am?
Oh, it would be wonderful. You'd show them.
What would I show them?
What you can do. Mr. Lorre, you must go to the studio.
You're a very sweet young woman.
Listen to me. Tell him you want to do it. What are we here for? We give in so soon. I've often thought we should fight, and those with talent should fight hardest. Don't you see? You must do it.
I'm nothing. I'm nothing. That's the truth.
And what about this case?
This maniac wants my name. Let him have it.
I mean, it's in all the papers.
I don't understand.
It's publicity. For them, for the studio, isn't it? Don't they owe you something? Tell them. Tell them you want to make this movie.
You want to remake M?
Yes.
This is good.
No, I'm serious.
I would hope so, because you have to say it's a long shot.
They owe me.
Do they?
I'm going to speak to Barclay.
Okay.
I feel good about it, Lester.
Well, I'm very pleased for you. But as becomes my role of late, I must remind you, Peter, of what is going on in the real world.
This is my moment. I can feel it.
Okay. Maybe he'll listen. After you've taken the stand tomorrow and everything has gone to
plan.
What? What?
I have to take the stand?
Of course.
But I don't care about it now.
You don't care about it? Do you think the studio loses this case, they're going to love you? They're going to welcome suggestions from you? Let me tell you, they will not.
Well, why does it matter to them?
Because they have invested. You're their property. You've got to be there any way you look at it, all right? You've read Weingand's deposition?
No.
Here, another copy. Prepare. Prepare. Make it all right.
Will you read something with me, Helen?
What is it?
Well, I've got to go on the stand tomorrow in court. It's like a script, but these are real words. His words, this man.
The one who wants your name?
Yeah. Like, I've marked it so you know where to read. You're the lawyer, Mr. Shooten. You don't have to worry about characterization. Just read it. I'm going to be Weingand. You start there.
Okay. What is the full name of your father?
I don't know.
What is the full name of your mother?
Alma Weingand.
Was your mother ever married, to your knowledge?
No, she was never married.
Was her home in Karlsruhe.
Karlsruhe, yeah.
In Germany in March and April of 1934?
I don't know what her home was then.
What I'm really asking is, were you born in the city in which your mother regularly lived?
I don't know. She lived several places.
How long did you live with your mother after you were born?
I lived with her occasionally.
Did she place you out for adoption?
No, I was never placed out for adoption.
Were you placed with foster parents?
Yes.
From right after your birth?
Yes.
Did your mother ever regularly care for you in her own home during the first 6 years of your life?
Irregularly, at times.
Shall I go on?
Yes, please, yes.
Was there any particular family that was the main family with whom you grew up or who took care of you as a child?
No, there was no particular family because I was 2 years here and 2 years someplace else.
Do you know who your father was?
No, I don't.
Did your mother know who your father was?
Well, I imagine she would have.
She knew?
Yes.
Did she ever tell you who your father was?
I don't recall.
You don't recall what she told you or whether she told you?
I don't recall whether she told me who my father was.
Did you ever ask her?
Well, I was very little living with my mother. My mother was sick, so there was no occasion for continuously bothering her.
Poor guy. Do I go on?
Strange.
What?
His life.
Oh, some life.
Well, exactly what I mean.
I have to go now, Mr. Lorre.
Could we just finish? Did you think I would be very grateful? Would you like a drink of water?
No, thank you.
Oh, okay. Begin, please.
Do you remember the occasion on which you first used the name Peter Lorre?
Well, it just all came about. People just started to call me that way. A lot of people just preferred me that way.
During the last 2 years, would you say that you used the name Peter Lorre more frequently?
Yes.
Than you used the name Eugene Weingand?
Yes.
Have you ever been in any public institution?
What do you mean by that?
I mean a hospital or prison.
I've been in a hospital, yes.
When?
About a year ago.
For what cause?
I had an accident.
What kind of accident?
I fell.
Down some stairs?
Yes.
Were you sober?
Yes, I was.
Do you drink intoxicating beverages?
I have, but I'm not.
Have you ever been treated for alcoholism?
No, I'm not. I attended a meeting of AA, but I'm not intoxicated.
Did you attend more than one meeting?
Yes.
How many meetings did you attend?
About 4 or 5.
Why do you go?
Just to learn, that's all.
To learn to stay away from liquor?
Perhaps.
Did you formerly drink to excess?
A little bit, who doesn't?
It's true, isn't it? You're going there to help yourself.
To help myself? No.
To help yourself with a problem?
No, I don't feel I have a problem now.
Did you ever feel you have a problem?
We all have problems. That's all there is.
Gee, he's a sad man.
Is that what you think of him?
I guess so.
You good? You ready?
I need to talk to you.
I like to talk, yes, but there isn't time. Afterwards.
I need to talk, Lester.
That's what I'm saying. We will talk. You read the deposition?
That's what I want to talk to you about.
Is he a sad sack?
Oh, he's wounded.
Yes, and we're going to wound him some more.
No, I mean, he's alive.
We're going to separate the guy from his balls today. And when the deed is done, the studio will rejoice. This may not be the moment, but I'll tell you anyway. Barkley is talking 2 pictures a year. Barkley is in court.
But listen,
his face shook you. I understand. We're going to bury it. We're going to put it behind us. Vacation, and then we begin.
No, Lester.
You just go in, play it straight, maybe a couple of ghoul jokes.
I don't want to testify.
Of course you don't want to testify.
I mean, I'm not going in.
Naturally, however.
I'm not going on the stand, Lester!
What? Is this nerves? Is that it? We can talk.
He never had anything.
This is
Weingart, Eugene Weingart.
He never had anything?
He doesn't know who he is.
He doesn't? Well, I do.
Because Lester,
I know who he is. He's a little guy on the make. He's a crook. He's a shyster.
It's funny. He wants my name.
Yes? Well, he's not gonna have it.
I feel I know him. That's all.
Okay. Here's how it is. You don't go in there today, and Barkley sees this, and sees you have not come to the aid of the studio.
2 films a year. I don't want to make them.
Okay, let's talk about M, the project that you and Miss Sugartits have dreamed up. Do you think Barkley would give you a minute of his time? You don't go in there today? Here it is. We will straighten this out, I promise you. But first things first. How much do you want to see your film made?
Be seated, please, and state your name.
My name is Peter Lorre. I hope you believe me.
What is your occupation or profession, Mr. Lorre?
I'm an actor.
How long have you been an actor?
Well, longer than I care to admit. I hate to call myself a star. I'd rather have other people call me a star, but I have been an actor since I was 17 or 18, and I was born in 1904. It makes me 59. So you can figure it out for yourself.
And you recall the first picture in which you had a starring role?
First picture I had a starring role in was the first picture I ever made. And it was a famous director, the most famous director in Europe, called, the picture was called M. And it's still running. It's running every year, at least 2 or 3 times in art houses and at the university. And it has one distinction I'm proud of. It's in general release in Europe again and is beating out every new picture that comes along. And this was made in 1930, Your Honor.
Have you any residuals in that picture?
Oh, I'm sorry to say no.
You had a bad agent.
Well, that was before Lester Salko, Your Honor. It was made in Europe, was it, Mr. Lorre?
Yes, sir, in Berlin.
And then you came to the United States.
Came to the United States in 1934.
And you made motion pictures for 20th Century Fox, for Columbia, with Warner Brothers.
Mm-hmm, yes. Several hard years of labor.
Do you have any idea how many pictures you made?
Well, I honestly don't know. But I think I'm fairly safe in saying that it's over 150. Certainly over 100.
And you've never performed under any other name than Peter Lorre?
No, I never have.
And in addition to this, you've worked on television?
Yes.
And you are presently under contract for 2 pictures a year?
Yes.
Anything further, Mr. Shuten?
That's all I have, Your Honor.
Any cross, counsel?
Yes. Is this an exclusive contract for 2 pictures a year?
Well, it's only exclusive in the sense that...
You make certain kinds of pictures?
Yes. Certain kinds of pictures, yes.
No more questions.
You may step down, Mr. Lorre.
May I say your performance in court tonight? You were beautiful. You took the stand like a small Hebraic Perry Mason.
Did you hear that, Peter?
I love the way you rolled your eyes.
Well, that's just a habit.
But a good one.
Two pictures a year.
That's what I heard.
You heard correct.
Mr. Barclay?
Peter.
I'd like to propose an idea to you, if I may.
We'll do this later, Peter.
Now, what is this? Yeah, put him on. Peter, your idea.
Well,
Stan! How is it with you, you dog? Yes, yes, I know that. And for why? Because, now wait a minute. Because of the system. The system. Well, it may surprise you, but then many things may surprise you. No, not that. Mrs. Barclay has only one of those. I'd love to. Peter, you were saying?
Could I just
We're letting him talk. Peter?
I was in a film once called M.
I know that. You said that in court.
It was very much acclaimed.
Okay, I heard you say that too.
I would like to suggest that the studio makes a new version of it. I think it would make a great movie.
You're serious?
It's just an idea, Mr. Barclay. Yeah, we've been kicking it around.
I'm serious.
Then let us take your suggestion seriously, because I respect you. Let us imagine this farmer comes home from work in Iktor, Idaho. He takes off his overalls. His wife says, "Dear, would you take me to the movies tonight?" He says, "What's on?" She says, "It's a movie called M."
Mr. Barclay...
Can I finish? Here's the crunch. The guy says, "What's it about?" She says, "It's about a maniac who cuts up little girls." And now, is our tired farmer going to leap up out of his chair and say, "Well, I must see that one"? I don't think so. And why? Because it may be big in Europe, but this is America, Peter.
He knows that, Mr. Barclay. It's
and I'm going to tell you something about America that you, as a foreigner, may not know. This country of ours does not welcome images of destroyed innocence, nor of children whose mothers are too busy to look after them, nor of perverts who cannot get it up except through sick and violent acts. Now, they may drool over this kind of thing in Europe, and that may tell you a lot about Europe's ills. But here, in the U.S. of A., it will not pass. In this country, we want stories in which children arrive home safe at night, and if anybody steps out of line, he will burn for it. Is that clear?
Perfectly, Mr. Barclay.
Because I do not wish to give offense.
None taken.
I know my business.
Well, if you don't, who does?
I just thought it would make a change from all the shit that comes out of here. That's all.
I beg your pardon?
I can explain this. He's...
You think we make shit here?
No, of course he doesn't, Mr. Barclay. He's just...
You come into my office.
Peter, I think... Mr. Barclay, we owe you
a... What the hell do you think you are, you Hebes? You come to our beautiful country. You suck on the tit of America's bounty.
We're just going.
You bet your ass you're going.
I promised you we're going to straighten this out.
You got the balls to tell me how to entertain Americans? You get out of here. Get out.
We're going.
And let me tell you something else. We lose today, your career is finished. And you'll be glad that fruitcake took your name because no one else will want it.
Do you rest, Mr. Shootin?
I have no further witnesses, Your Honor.
Any rebuttal, counsel?
Yes, a short rebuttal.
Mr. Weingand, would you take the stand, please?
When you arrived, when did you first come to the United States?
In 1954.
Could you speak English at that time?
No, I couldn't.
You learned English after you came to this country?
Yes, I did, yeah.
When did you first become engaged in the selling of real estate, Mr. Lorre?
About 2 years ago.
I object to Mr. Weingand being called Mr. Lorre. I'm sorry. I'm confused. So many names. I call him that when he comes to my office.
Should have called you as a witness.
I might do that, Your Honor. Mr. Weingand, apart from real estate, do you have any other income whatsoever?
No.
Do you have any inclination to be a movie actor or a stage actor or any type of actor whatsoever?
Not at the moment, no.
Not at the moment. That's the answer.
How about in the future?
Your answer is well made. Who can plan for the future? If the court should grant your petition and a film producer should come along and offer you a part in one of his pictures, would you take it?
May I say this, Your Honor? My firm belief is that if a person is talented, he doesn't have to take anyone's name in order to be an actor.
Then why not take the name of Jack Benny or Bob Hope? They're easier to pronounce than Lorre. Why did you pick the name Peter Lorre?
Because people call me that way.
They said you look something like him?
Perhaps, yeah.
I have no further questions, Your Honor.
Petitioner rests?
Petitioner rests.
Objector rests?
Objector rests, Your Honor.
Well, this develops into a very simple situation. There's no question in the court's mind that the only reason this man wants to change his name is to, if I may use the parlance of the street, cash in on the reputation established over a period of years by Peter Lorre. I don't think the petitioner is acting in good faith, using this as a means to interfere with the right established with a man over many, many years of work. The petition for change of name is denied. That is the judgment of the court.
Dear Eugene, though this is a letter you will never receive, I felt I wanted to write it to you. You want my name. You still want it? I came here like you, as an immigrant. I thought, America, yes. I thought I was a serious actor, and that America would find a place for me. Well, America said, yes, you can come here. You can join in, but only if you let us tell you who you are. I said, okay. You know what that means? It means I lost myself. You still want to be me? A face maker? Okay. Then be prepared to pay the price.
I made it all right for you, Peter. I kissed his ass till my lips went numb. I got that done for you, so we get to keep the movies. You gonna sign this for me now?
Dear Mr. Lorre, I just wanted to say I hope there are no hard feelings about the court case. You looked a little puffy on the stand. You need to take care of yourself. I hope you aren't hitting the booze too hard, because I've been there and I know it doesn't work. Try to remember, this is a great country where a man can choose who he wants to be. If we give in to the demons that haunt us, we end up lost and broken, and that's not where I'm heading. Though I don't suppose we'll ever meet, I feel sure we'll always be friends. Thanks for everything. Yours in sincerest admiration, Peter Lorre, Jr.
Peter Lorre died in March 1964. 7 months after the court's ruling. In December of that year, Eugene Weingand sought and won a new ruling which modified Judge Wolfson's permanent injunction. His driving license and Social Security card were both changed to the name Peter Lorre, Jr. Under this name, he played several small roles in television, as well as making an appearance in the low-budget horror The Cat Creature. His last impersonation of Peter Lorre was in 1983, when he played Booberry in the TV commercial for General Mills' Frankenberry, Count Chocula, and Booberry cereals. He died in 1984.
Peter Lorre was played by Stephen Greif, Lester Salco by Peter Marinka, Helen by Helen Longworth, and Eugene Weingand by Kenneth Collard. The judge was John Rowe, Shutan, Kerry Shale, Gemmell, John Chancer, and Barclay and Jack Parr, Nathan Osgood. Peter Lorre versus Peter Lorre was written by Michael Butt and directed by Toby Swift. With thanks to Lorre's biographer, Stephen D. Youngkin.
After the news, Moneybox Live takes your calls on saving and investment.
BBC News at 3 o'clock. Police in Shropshire have found a third body at a mansion which was destroyed by fire last week. Yesterday, tests confirmed that one of the dead was Jill Foster, the wife of a businessman, Christopher Foster, whose company had gone into liquidation. The body of a man was found close by. The fate of the couple's daughter is unknown. Gordon Brown has said the European Union is united in its opposition to Russia's recent actions in Georgia. Speaking ahead of an emergency summit in Brussels, he said member states also wanted to show solidarity with Georgia.